want to minister to a topic shall title The Essence of Equity. Equity is fairness without partiality. In whatever you do, in anywhere you are called upon to lead people, in your office place, in your political career place, in your business place, in that association where you belong to, whether in your community, in the church, anywhere you are called upon to lead people or to relate with people, I come to beg you, please practice equity. For no one knows tomorrow. For the one that is rich today may be poor tomorrow. And the one that is poor today may be rich tomorrow. Life is not certain for anybody. Change is inevitable and it is constant. God made it so. And the Bible said, where we study, if a man come to your ministry with a royal apparel, being rich, and you now present and put him in a better position, in a good seat, and put the poor to sit on the floor in your footstool, he said, are you not partial against yourself? Until you practice and until we start to practice equity in this kingdom, equality will not manifest. Until you become fair without partiality, the same and equal opportunity cannot be given to all of us. In this country where we are, we were under the government called democracy. But what we see them practice is nepotism. Nepotism is the government of favoritism that favors only their relatives and their friends and the members of their close paths. No equity. No equality. And those who are there in the government are also part of this, our kingdom. They have started to bring that system from the government of Nigeria into Christianity in Nigeria. Where if you are rich, you'll be ordained elder in the church. If you are rich, you have a place to sit before the altar and before the pastors. If you are rich, you have a place. Whenever they want to do anything, they will call upon you for an idea because you are rich. And the Bible said that we are equal in the eyes of God. Anywhere you go to, and you start to treat people because of what you think you can achieve or acquire from them, and neglect others, at the end of the day, you might discover that those you belittle might be the one who really have genuine heart for you. Equity must be practiced. If the people in the world, in the political gathering, in the government association, are being practicing nepotism, let us start from this, our kingdom, to start to practice equity and take it along and carry it to that very organization where we belong to. And behold, people will start to emulate us. And time will come, everybody will start to live like that. There are people who say, no. There are ways they do things here. There are ways they do this here. Let us do it different. Some people now know that, no, this person is fair in all her judgment, in all his judgment, she is or he is fair. There is no partiality in her or in him. If we continue to live like that, a time will come, it will grow in the society. People will start to learn from us. But let us start from the church. Let's start to treat ourselves equally. Stop seeing yourself better than another person. Stop seeing yourself bigger than another person. Stop thinking that because of the way you dress, that nobody can dress like you. By the time the new model will come out, you might not have money to buy. Because you were not created to continue to buy clothes every day. People who are not able to buy now will be able to buy tomorrow. There are people who are not big and rich. There is something they are which the rich did not have. Equity must be practiced. So that by so doing, you'll be able to be a blessing to everybody, respective of their status. Because you don't know who is who, and you don't know who will become who tomorrow. Equity is very important. Let me talk to somebody. If you refuse to practice equity in your organization or wherever you find yourself, you will create a lot of problems which you can never solve. Because there are many people in the Word of God which who have refused to practice equity who were partial in doing what they have done, and what evil that they created, and the consequence of what they created, till now they could not solve it. Even now, we cannot solve it, according to the word of God. Many characters, many people who did what they did partially, and they could not practice equity. They created a problem that nobody was able to solve. Until now, is a problem to this kingdom. Number one, practice equity to avoid hatred in the family. Genesis chapter 37, verse 3 and 4. And the Bible said that Jacob loved Joseph more than all his children and gave him a cloth and made a cloth of many colors for him. And the brother knew that their father loved Joseph more than them. And the Bible says they hated him for it. So those things that happened, that he had a dream and they now sold him because of a dream. People who did not read the Bible did not know exactly the truth, because this Bible, we preach it according to the topic. But the truth is that the hatred have started before the dream. They hated him because the father loved him more than all his brothers. Jacob did not practice equity in his house, and that made 11 children to hate one person. So anything that comes from Joseph does not make any meaning to them. They are already angry with him. They hated him because Jacob loved him alone. He made coat of many colors, both red, yellow, green, purple, black, white. Every color was found in that coat. Why didn't he divide the color and give everybody one handkerchief? Yes, since you are patching it and joining it to become one coat, you could have known that it's going to be a problem. Divide it. And let all your children have one handkerchief. Let it be one handkerchief instead of using it to do make one coat for one person. And they hated him for that. And that made them to sold him. They sold him into slavery. They even wanted to kill him. Practice equity to avoid hatred in the family. Practice equity to avoid hatred in the family. If not for anything, but because of this one, practice it. Always practice equity. Wherever you go, whether in your house, among your children, among your siblings, in your business, practice it. To avoid hatred in your family. Number two, practice equity to avoid standing ovation for who you did not regard. 1 Samuel chapter 16, from verse 1 to 12. The Bible said that Prophet Samuel, God spoke to him and said, how many times are you going to mourn for Saul? Go to the family of Jesse and anoint me a king. And the Bible says, Prophet Samuel went to the family of Jesse and he said, prepare me, your children, your sons, that I have come to anoint one of them to be king of Israel. And the Bible says he produced 7 able men, soldiers. Some were captains and commanders. And the Bible said they were sanctified. It means they were given privilege to bath. They had their bath and they dressed well. For they dressed in their better attire so that they can receive the anointing to be king. They had to dress to look like king. And the Bible said that Prophet Samuel stood in their front and tried to anoint Abner. And God said, this one, I don't know him. And he passed through many of them. And God said to him, you look outward, me God, I look inward. These ones can never be king over Israel. And the Bible says, after 7 of them passed through Prophet Samuel, Prophet Samuel now said to the father Jesse in verse 11, is there any that among your children that remained? And he said, there is one in the bush that used to take care of the animals. If they value him, they will invite him when they were inviting others. They did not invite him because the mother did not have him in his father's house. David was not a son of another woman. It was the same woman that had those 7 children that had David. But what happened is that the mother left the father's house without knowing that she was pregnant. It was her family who went to Jesse to inform him that our sister is with a child. And Jesse did not think or believe that that child belongs to him. So after the birth of David, they now returned David to him. That was why he was treating David so. Read your Bible. In verse 11 and 12, the Bible said that Samuel said to Jesse, go and fetch that your son, and we will remain standing until he arrives. And the seven of Jesse's children, who are captains and commanders of the soldiers of Israel, remain standing with their attires. The David arrived from bush. And they didn't ask him to take his bet. He did not bet. They didn't sanctify him. They did not allow him to wear cloth. And immediately he arrived. God spoke to Samuel, "That is my king. Anoint him now." And he was anointed. Listen. In the whole record of the Bible, there was no place where David recognized any of his elder brother that it was recorded. No one was his counselor. No one was a soldier under him. No one was closer to him. No one he related with because of the way they treated him. Even when he went to war after the anointing, they still see him as nobody. He was telling them, "Who is this circumcised Philistine?" They say, "Shut up. You don't come again. Get out from this place. You are too small. Are you a soldier? You are too small to handle things. Quiet. Quiet." Because that is how they have been talking down on him, because he's a small boy. Because they didn't place any regard on him. Because the father refused to practice equity in his own house. And God proved to them that he is the God that have anointed him. And he is the God that giveth glory. And God empowered David. And David was the one who slayed the giant of the Philistines in the presence of his seven brothers who were trained soldiers. They were humiliated. It was his father, Jesse, who caused that problem. And immediately David became a soldier. All his brothers were retired. And they were not recognized. And they were not recorded in the Bible anymore. No place again that they were found in the Bible. Apart from 1 Samuel chapter 16. Nobody again speaks about their name. No prophecy for them. And immediately after that place, Jesse's reign ended. Immediately David was anointed, Jesse, the reign of his father Jesse, were cut off. If you don't want to give standing ovation for whom you don't regard, treat everybody equally. Practice equity. Because tomorrow is pregnant. And what is going to deliver, you don't know. If you are not fair in treating people and you are practicing partiality, the day is going to come to you. The day God will dish it to you. If you are not careful, people you rejected, people you neglect, will come above you where you will not start to serve them. This kingdom, and outside this kingdom, no one has it all. And no one knows it all. There are people who are bad beginning, and they will make good ending. There are good beginning that will make bad. So you cannot predict everything. Practice equity. Fairness without partiality. Number three, practice equity to avoid being captain by whom you have rejected. If you are not right, practice equity to avoid being captain by whom you have rejected. John chapter 11, verse 1 to 6. The word of God said a man called Jephthah was born into the family of Gilead. And the father, Gilead, married another woman. And that woman have other children. And when those children grows up, they throw Jephthah away, saying that you are a son of a strange woman. You cannot share our father's house with us. The father was alive. The stepmother was there when the younger ones and the siblings throw him away. And the Bible says he left them and went to dwell in the land of Tom. And when men gather together and join him to become his warrior and go with him. And the Bible says, "Time come, the children of Ammon rise and they rose up against the children of Gilead to battle with them, to quench them, to destroy them." And the Bible said that the elders of Gilead now remembered that the only warrior that children of Ammon fears that can conquer them is Jephthah. They now send the elders of Gilead to go and fetch Jephthah. And they went to Jephthah in verse 5 and 6. And they begged Jephthah, "Come, because children of Ammon want to destroy us. Come and join us to fight a war and become our captain." And he gave them condition in verse 10 and 11. That you will make me your head and your leader. That is the only way I can come to defend you. Because you people rejected me as your brother. If you refuse to practice equity, problem might come, which people you have rejected might be the one who have the solution to that very problem. I don't know how you're going to beg. I don't know how you're going to talk to them. I don't know how you're going to go to them. But it's going to be difficult, and you will be ashamed of yourself that somebody that you have rejected have now went to employ that person to captain you. Somebody will say he is not qualified to partake in sharing of your father's thing, to partake in sharing with you, to partake in eating with you, to partake in wearing the same clothes with you, and you chase him away. Now is the one that has solution to your problem. I don't know how you're going to start. I don't know how you're going to meet him. I don't know who you will send to go and apologize to him. I don't know how you're going to write the apology letter. I don't know how it will happen. I don't know how you will put it together. I don't know who you will send. And I don't know if the person will agree. Because I know Jephthah gave them condition. If you read further, that is how Jephthah emerged to become the leader of the generation of Gilead. Because since they rejected him and they came for him, he gave them condition. You will make me your leader. And all those who chased him away were serving under him. Number 4. Practice equity to avoid everlasting conflicts. In Genesis chapter 16, from chapter 16 to chapter 24, and the Bible says a man called Abraham married to a woman called Sarah. And Sarah could not give him a child. Rather, Sarah persuaded him and motivated him to sleep with their maid. And that their maid gave birth to a son called Ishmael. Automatically, Ishmael becomes the first child. Because after the birth of Ishmael comes Isaac. And the Bible says they groan. And when Abraham is about to die, the Bible says after Sarah died, that Abraham married another woman called Keturah. Here, I want to educate you. There is no difference between Keturah and Hagar. Hagar is Keturah. Keturah means in Hebrew, the burnt woman. Meaning that Hagar, the slave, came back to Abraham's house. It was stated that Abraham went back to marry Hagar properly according to the rite of marriage because Sarah was dead. That the woman, burnt woman, because he has Ishmael, stayed away from Sarah and Abraham until Sarah died. So there's no difference between Keturah and Hagar. Keturah is nobody's name. Keturah means that Abraham married that burnt woman. Burnt woman means the maid. I hope you understand it now. Because some people read the Bible will tell you that Abraham after Hagar have a child for him, that he married Sarah, Sarah have Isaac, and now man another woman called Keturah. There's no other woman called Keturah. Keturah is Hagar. Keturah means the burnt woman who have a child for him before. And he married the woman proper. And the woman have another 6 children who happens to be younger brothers to Ishmael of the same mother, the same father. And when Abraham died, the Bible says Abraham have stated his will to his kindred that they should give only gift to Ishmael and all the other children of Hagar and give everything to Isaac. And that is where problem started. And that conflict has been since then till now. In Genesis 25 to 27, even with what they did to Ishmael, Isaac did not open his eyes when he wanted to bless. He did not open his eyes. He had 2 children in chapter 25. By a woman called Rebecca. And one is Esau, the other one is Jacob. And the Bible says, a time cometh when he wants to bless them. He said to Esau, go and bring me very so I might bless you. Before Esau came back, Rebecca have perfected her own way. Her own way have perfected it to make sure that that blessing goes to the small one called Jacob. And behold, it was so. Venison blinded him not to be able to know that Jacob was wearing animal skin. That is not so. Even when he said, your skin is like Esau, but your voice is the voice of Jacob. He could not stop because he had started to test the pepper soup. He went ahead to bless. And when Esau came back, listen, and Esau said, Father, what has happened? He said, I'll bless your brother. He said, okay, is there any blessing left for me? He said, no. Nothing. Except you will get anything you want to get by sword. And Esau grew angry. And that is the moment conflict started between Esau's generation and Jacob's generation. Jacob ran away because he knew that his brother is no longer happy. Even when he came back with softness, the brother is already rich. He said, go that way east. Don't return to the north. I don't want to see you. I've forgiven you. Go. And that Esau married Ishmael's daughter. And they formed this religion that have been a problem that we now have conflict with, and we don't know what caused the problem till tomorrow. It was because Abraham did not practice equity. Isaac did not practice equity. He did not treat his children equally.